Let's see now. Where were we? Oh, yeah. Well, next step is trenching for pipe. Now, when I broke into this business, we used to do this job by hand. But nowadays, we've got a fancy big piece of equipment that just eats its way along, chewing out a nice, clean trench, piling the soil neatly alongside. But sometimes you'll see those buckets start to shudder and stall. You know you've hit a rock ledge. That's when you start yelling for the powder man. Looks easy, the way they sink their shot holes. But it takes quite a little know-how to lay out the shot right. There's an act to packing the charge, too. He's got to know how to handle that stuff. One mistake and you're going to need a new powder man. At last, he ties in all the fuses so they'll go off together. And then you hear the signal, fire in the hole. That means find the cover. And quick. Rocks and boulders come down like hail for a while. Then the backhoe goes to work clearing out the mess. Watch it a while and you'll see where that machine gets its name. And a good man can really make it behave, just as accurate and easy as hoeing weeds on his pappy's farm. Even on grades so steep you gotta haul equipment up on a winch, he just keeps scooping out rocks and dirt, ready in the trench for pipe. And when that old pipe starts rolling in, everything kind of picks up. Now you're really in the pipeline business. But you gotta remember, this ain't garden hose you're laying. It's 26-inch steel pipe weighing more than a ton and a half for each 40-foot joint. And it's gotta be fitted to the lay of the land. After a while, the section's laid out rough, like the pieces of a puzzle. Now the trimming and fitting begins. Flame slices through steel like scissors through silk. And so the trimmed edges will fit exactly. A line of clamps run through each section to hold each joint in absolute alignment while welders give it what they call a stringer bead, just tacking the pipe into position. Gradually, the individual sections are joined together, forming a solid line that stretches off in both directions far as the eye can see. Then, more welding. This time, the finish bead stronger than the pipe steel itself. Always, there's an inspector with an eye like an eagle, followed by an x-ray photo of all joints. Then the manicuring begins. Whirling steel brushes scrape off all the rust and dirt, and the pipe's given a heavy coating of lacquer. Usually that's enough. But where the soil tends to be corrosive, more protection's needed. And the pipe gets an additional coat of tar and a final wrap in a fiberglass. Then, just to be sure, the whole pipe's inspected with an electronic detector that puts the finger on any flaws in the coating.
Fussy?
Sure. But this pipe's got to stay put a long time. Finally, it's ready to be laid in. The big side boom cats pick up the line, and in a nice little bit of teamwork, start for the trench. It's funny to watch how gently they handle these hundreds of tons of pipe. Like a mother with her baby. But you got to remember, This line is tailored to the hill like the coat on your back. It's got a fit to a gnat thigh latch. And it does. As the pipeline grows, you're constantly reminded that this is wilderness. And you wonder what the effect will be on these people. But you don't wonder long. There's too much to do. Now comes the cleanup, covering over the line so as it'll be safe for the next 100 years or so. This is the last of the job, one of the most important and roughest. Even the cats can't get sure footing in the salt soil. And sometimes a driver gets a mite too ambitious. We lose a lot of cats that way. While we're cleaning up here, way up ahead, the line's pushing into new territory and new problems, like the Potomac River. It's not as wide as the Mississippi, but it's tough. I've crossed them both. The Potomac's shallow and the bed is solid rock. So, 17 tons of blasting jelly it took. But when the rocks and water quit falling, there was our pipe bed just as neat as you please. Of course, you know at river crossings we split the main pipe into several smaller lines just in case. If something should happen to one or even two of these pipes, automatic check valves would seal them off and the gas would keep flowing through the others. Folks on the line would never even know something has happened. With the river crossed, the crew at Rockville starts getting ready for the tying. First step is bleeding the old lines, letting out the gas. There's usually a cop around to keep curious folks back, especially smokers. Then while one gang's busy cutting into the old lines, another gang is fitting the joints and bends to tie into the incoming line. Watching them sweating over their big screw jacks and hoists, it seems kind of funny to call this a precision operation. But that's just what it is. Precision on an overgrown scale. Well, that's about it. As soon as the line's all buttoned up, they'll be building a control station over this spot, all full of white tile and shiny instruments. But we'll be long gone by then. Our job is in the dirt. Yeah, when the official ceremonies are going on, and important people are making speeches about this significant contribution to progress, we'll be off somewheres else. Pushing pipe on some other line. But that's all right. We had the satisfaction of licking that toughest inch for keeps. That's enough.